Hey, and welcome. If you're watching this on the 18th of May, 2023, happy Global Accessibility Awareness Day. If you're watching this on a different day, welcome. So in this video that supports the article we posted on the MDN blog, I'm going to look at using some of the tools that was mentioned in the section going beyond color contrast. So the first one we're going to look at is Lighthouse. And as I mentioned, when you open Lighthouse by default, usually all of these elements are checked. But because we only want to run the accessibility ones, we're going to uncheck all of them. Now, also, I'm running this in incognito mode. The reason for that is sometimes some browser extensions that you have can have a negative impact on the results of Lighthouse. So it's therefore recommended to run your Lighthouse tests when running it in the browser inside an incognito tab where those extensions won't have an effect. Okay, so I've decided to go with facebook.com, and it's the number one in that 1 million pages, one of the collections that the report was made up from. And we're gonna run just on their facebook.com landing page, we're gonna run accessibility tests for desktop specifically. To do that, I click the Analyze Page Load button, and then Lighthouse is going to do its thing and it's going to give us a report. Auditing. Almost there. There we go. So with Lighthouse, the Facebook.com landing page is getting a score of 97. And what it's mainly calling out is there's some background and foreground colors that do not have sufficient contrast ratio, something we talked about previously. And here it highlights some of the elements, and you can see when you hover over it here, it shows the offending elements. And then should you click one, it'll show you where it is in here. And indeed, if we go and we click on the foreground color here, we'll see that it fails. It fails AA and it fails AAA. So, but now what I want to call out is that if we look at the Lighthouse score, it gives it 97. Now, Lighthouse can sometimes be a little too forgiving in these cases, and that's why it's important to not only rely on a single tool when you're doing these audits. So over and above the fact that I've mentioned that there are some things you need to test manually, and we'll talk a little about that in a second, it's also important to not only rely on a single automated tool and assume if Lighthouse gives you 97, you're good. So now we're going to switch over to a different Chrome window, this time not in incognito mode, and we're going to use Axe. So that's the other one that I mentioned. So we're still on facebook.com, but now we have Axe here. So I've installed the Axe dev tools in Chrome, and when you open your developer tools, right along with all your other ones, you'll also see an entry now for Axe DevTools. Now, the Axe DevTools have got two versions, the one we're going to be using in this demo today, but then there's another one that gives you guided tests that allows you to do a lot more than just automated tests. So what these guided tests do is they tell you, it identifies a number of things on the page, and it tells you to kind of categorize them and say whether it was correctly identified or incorrectly identified. It would, for example, say, this looks like it should be a list. And then you can look at it and say, oh yeah, that should actually be a list. And then you could mark that and it'll create this big report that you can have at the end that you can then use to go fix a bunch of problems. You can also do stuff like it'll tab through your page and it'll show you the order it went in, and you can say if that is the order that a user would have expected it to go through. If not, then this is something you need to look at. It can do all kinds of stuff. It can work with dialogues, a lot of things. But even with the free version, there's quite a lot here. And if we see, once we run this, scan all of my page here, you will see that the results produced by Axe is quite different than the ones from Lighthouse. So let's run that. So I'm going to click this button here. It's going to run it. And you can see there's 54 total issues. There is moderate here. There's quite a few serious ones. And you can see one of the biggest problems on this page is 41 items do not match pause color contrast. And here we can actually cycle through them and see what the different ones are. And again, if you click on the little inspect element here, it's going to take you to the element over here. And if we click the color, indeed we can see it is not passing contrast. So if we head back to our Xdev tools, we can also see that beyond that, there's no H1 on this page. It's the heading start at H2, and then it talks about landmarks. And so there's quite a few things here that the Xdev tools considers, is suggesting that it should be contained within a landmark, but they are not. Now, again, if we click here, we can have a sense. So here, for example, we have a list of links, and you know, this might be navigation. And so maybe you'd want to put that in a navigation landmark. This is also the footer, so you could use the footer element and then have it identified as content info by that implicit role that I talked about in the landmarks role article. So, you know, there's quite a lot of problems here. And as you can see, these were not highlighted by Lighthouse. So the other nice thing here is it gives you some suggestions on how you can fix it. And you can also click on these links that will take you to more information about the specific error. So that is this one. It also has best practices on, and here it is looking at WCAG 2.1 AA. So it's not even looking at AAA. You can see here that there's the guided tests, but at the moment, if we log over to it, you know, I can try it for free, but you have to pay to use that. And there's a very good reason for it. And it's really good tools if you pay for that. But that aside, let's move on to the next tool. So the next one we're going to run in Firefox. And again, we're on Facebook.com. This time we're going to open the DevTools and we're going to use the Accessibility Inspector here in DevTools. Now, as you can see, it shows us the accessibility tree here. We can enable this. Let me just zoom in a little bit so it's easier to see. There we go. So we can check this and it'll show us the tab order that's going to happen on this page. And so, you know, 1, 2, 3, that's totally expected. So that's good. Now, check for issues. Let's check for all issues. And again, it's reporting a lot of issues for us, almost all of them to do with contrast. Now, I'll show you something else when we use the Wave tool from WebAIM. But for example, here you can see the password field and it says the form element should have a visible text label. And here it talks about clickable elements must be focusable and should have interactive semantics. Now, and again, we have the same text label problem with our email address input field. Interesting. And you can limit this to only contrast, only keyboard, or only text labels. With that, oh, no, it's gone to none, text labels. There we go. But then there's the other tool that I mentioned that you can do, and that is simulating different color modes. So somebody with Protanopia will see the page like this. And especially when you go to something like Tritanopia, you'll start seeing why it's important to not only rely on color. You can see that all three of these elements are very close in terms of color between each other. And if you go to contrast loss, you can see, you know, it's getting really hard to do that. So these are also the different, and then there's this one where it's just grayscale. So again, can you understand what each of the different elements is? There's not a lot going on here, but even now you can see the contrast problem here is even more evident when we go there. Okay, so that are some of the tools built into the Firefox DevTools. Now we're going to close this one, and now we're going to use Wave, which is up here. And I'm going to click it, and it'll run immediately. And it's adding all kinds. You can turn those off. Whoops, if I do this, what it does is it disables CSS. So this is what this page will look like if no CSS is being loaded. You can already see something suspicious here with these inputs that was highlighted by Firefox. Now, you might expect there's actual labels here, but that they were visually hidden with CSS. But now that the CSS is turned off, you might expect to see these labels, but they're not. And you can see what they've done is instead they've used aria label on the input elements as opposed to using a label element. And again, first rule of aria, if there is an HTML element that fulfills your need, use it over using aria. Okay, so let's turn styles back on. So here you can see the problem here where it says there's no H1 on this page. Right, now if you click into view details, you can start seeing more of these. Now, here's an image with missing alternative text. Now, if you go through to it shows us this image over here, but there's nothing there. But so if you click on it, it's going to tell you a little bit more. Again, reference. If you click the code, it's going to open up this little drawer here and show you where the problem is. Now, you can see here is the tracking pixel that doesn't have even an empty alt attribute. It just doesn't have an alt at all. All right. And then we have all of these. So each of these ones is contrast. So you can see that one has contrast problems. There's contrast problems. There's contrast problems. And if, for example, we go, let's go to the green button and let's open Firefox. Go to Inspector. Let's go to this one. So here we are. And now if we choose the color, again, here we can see that it's 2.61, so it's not meeting color contrast. Right, so let's close that. And then if you scroll down, there's some more where there's alerts or like warnings. So here it's saying there's redundant alternative text. The interesting thing here is this is an image and the alternate text is Facebook, but this says that there's an H2 right by it that contains the same name. So therefore it considers this as purely decorative, and therefore it can use an empty alt text as opposed to one that just restates what's already here. Now, okay, the missing H1. And then here it highlights access keys. So here's another nice thing. So here's a little information icon. When you click that, it takes you to the reference that explains what this is. So it says it means an access key attribute is present. But why it matters is access keys provide a way to define shortcut keys for web page elements. Access keys often conflict with user or assistive technology shortcut keys and should be avoided or implemented with care. So, you know, here's a couple of, like, to get to help and to get to terms and about, and I think there's a couple more. There are access keys. Here is redundant title text. So the reason why it says that is if we go into this one and we look at the code, then we'll see that inside that link it says Afrikaans, but the link also has a title attribute with the same name. So that is unnecessary because you're duplicating it here. So it's redundant. So you can see, even though Lighthouse gave this page a really good score, when you look at these different tools, they paint a different picture. So again, don't just rely on one, try a couple of them and see what the different ones show up. That is, you know, and before you just decide that, yes, this is 97 with Lighthouse, we're all good to go. And again, if we go to contrast here, all kinds of nice little tools here that you can play with, and you can head back to the summary, which shows you an overview. All right, so that is a quick video to show you how these tools work and what you can do with them. There's a lot more to dig in here, but you can see, use different tools. And then if we dig into this even deeper and we start doing some of those guided tests, or we just start using a keyboard and we try and we're like, can I get to everything on this page? And if we then also use and learn to use a screen reader, then we can really start to understand how the user experience is for these different people trying to use the service or product that we've built. I hope you found this useful. Thank you for watching. And if you have any questions, you need any help with any of this, please join our Discord and we'll find the link to it in the article. Speak to you soon.